Donna Malone! The cinema today is in a crisis. Directors are so existentialist.
While we were doing our casting for Nine, we cast at the Edison Theater in New York, and a woman came out on stage with a wonderful French accent, and she looked up past the lights, and she said, "Hello, darling, hello, Tommy, you know, I am Liliane Montevecchi, and I was in a movie, The Young Lion, with Marlon Brando in 1950, and so I have gone to Hollywood to ask them to make me star, but they do not want to make me star, so I am on my way back to Paris. And I thought I would ask you, maybe you have some small role for me in your show. It does not matter anything at all, as long as I am on stage 5 minutes, alone." Well, of course, it was hilarious. And I said, "Gee, she's fantastic." And he said, "Well, don't you know Liliane Montevecchi?" I said, "No, forgive me, I don't." I said, she's a really good singer? He said, "Well, yeah, but not a singer. I said, "Dancer." He said, "Well, she can dance, but, you know, she's not Sid Charisse." I said, "Actress." He said, "Well, yeah, kind of." I said, "Well, what does she do?" And he said, "That." And I thought, well, she's wonderful. And you know, why can't she be the producer? You know, we don't have a song for the producer. It's a non-singing role. It wouldn't be too demanding. And she could be the producer. And so Liliane Montevecchi signed on to be the producer. She owns the Folies Bergères, and that's how she made the money. And she's going to give Guido the money, because nobody else will give Guido money. And on the very first day of teaching the overture, I asked every member of the company to come to the piano one by one to find their vocal range, so that women who had a high C could be my first violins, women who had a lyric G could be the second violins and the violas, women who had a deep chest, booming voice could be my deep woodwinds and my brass, and of course women who were contraltos could be my basses. Because I was writing for them as if they were an orchestra. And finally, I had met everybody except Liliane, and she was over at the side, and I said, "Well, Liliane, come sing me a few notes," because I figured maybe she can fill in a harmony chord, nothing terribly demanding. I said, "Sing me something." So of course she sang la 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 la, and she was fine. She was the Maury Chevalier that I heard and the Edith Piaf coming out of the radio when I was 5 years old, north of Montreal. And I just couldn't get out of my head, because I've always loved Chevalier, I've always loved Piaf, and I've always loved that, and I always wanted to write for that. And that night, literally that night, I was at the piano, and I was staying in a little hotel room, and I thought, wouldn't it be great if I could just write a little soupçon, something very, very small, in which she could just nostalgically remember her days at the Folies Bergères. And I heard it in my head, and I thought, wouldn't that be sweet? Folies Bergère. And I wrote this little tune. And I thought, well, better get permission for this. And I called Tommy and I said, "Look, I've had a little idea, just something tiny and nostalgic. It's just, it would give her such personality." He said, "What is it?" I said, "Well, it's for Liliane." "Oh, great." Well, he said, "Well, let me hear it." And I said, "Well, I had my phone." And I went, "Because Folies Bergères, what a showing of color costume." He said, "Oh, great. Keep writing it." I said, "Yeah, but I'll wake up tomorrow morning and I'll think it's a bad idea, so please, not a word." He said, "Absolutely not a word." And the next day at rehearsal, it was 9 a.m, and I was at the piano, and somebody came up behind me and said, "Darling, is it true you're writing for me a song?" And I was then committed. And so we had this little song, Folies Bergères. Well, the problem was, how does she get into singing? And I thought, oh, I know what to do. She'll say to him, "Tell me about your movie." And he's got nothing. He's got no idea at all. So he'll make up something ridiculous, outlandish, surrealistic, and impossible. And so I said to Arthur Copit, our book writer, I think the way we get into this song is for her to say, "Tell me about your movie." And he has to say something ridiculous, surrealistic, outlandish, and impossible. And she has to say, "Well, that's ridiculous. I want you to make me a musical. I want singing. I want dancing. I want the Folies Bergères." Arthur came in the wings of where we were rehearsing at the New Amsterdam roof. Arthur had a little, believe it or not, a typewriter, and And he typed a page of, you know, well, okay, here's my idea. Okay, we begin this movie. We're in a graveyard, and there's a man. He's buried alive, and he can't get out of it, and he's late for an appointment for lunch. And I said, well, this is nuts in the best way. And we gave it to Toon, and Toon looked at it, and then he looked at me, and he said, and this was Arthur's first musical. And Tommy said, okay, so do you want to tell him, or should I tell him? And I said, no, you tell him. And Tommy said, Arthur, this is one of the thankless tasks about being involved in a musical. When we have something like this, generally speaking, it's often a good idea to think about maybe it could go into song. And so it became, tell me about your movie. And of course, the action begins in a graveyard. A man has been buried alive. He's scratching and clawing. He's caught in a terrible crunch. He's late for an appointment. Everything that Arthur had written, I basically turned into, which is, of course, the best kind of collaboration ever. And I guess, you know, they don't call them toxicals. And so we had this little introduction. Then, as Liliane was learning it and we were watching it, there's always a vital question that one must ask. And this was taught me really by my mentor, Lehman Engel. He said, look, if somebody is on stage singing a song, you must ask the question, what is everybody else on stage doing while they're singing it? Well, on stage at the time, right there in the scene, was the critic, played by my friend Stephanie Katsourilos, who had been to the Yale School of Music and the Yale School of Drama. We had done a show together at the Yale Rep. Intensely bright, brilliant soprano actress. She had done some Kurzweil downtown at the Public. And she was playing this incisive, bitter, rough, mean critic. And I thought, well, there's a critic on stage. Well, what critic can ever shut up, right? So she's got to chime in. So I had this Folie Bergère, and I thought, well, she could chime in with, you know, the trouble with Katina. He's the king of mediocrity. He's a second-rate director who believes that he's Socrates. He never makes a movie, or he makes a film. Get it, a film. And so I wrote the critic's obligato. And because I love counterpoint, and I think that that's one of the things that really entertains people, I thought, well, that's going to make a nice scene. He'll say the action begins in a graveyard. She'll sing Give Me Folie Bergère. The critic will criticize him. And then she will finish with Folie Bergère, the trick with Katina, and which is very vastly entertaining, and will come to an end. Or so I thought. The problem is that in order to come to an end, you have to hit a very high note or do a fabulous dance step or something. And we felt that that was asking too much for Liliane to deliver all by herself. And so we thought, we'll have to bring in everybody else and do something spectacular. Well, we didn't know what to do. And so we thought, well, tomorrow's another day. I got a phone call that night from Michael Stewart, who was one of the producers and a good friend of Toon, and who had helped produce and also design costumes for Hollywood Ukraine. He's a very bright guy. And he said, we've had an idea, and come to rehearsal tomorrow a little bit early. And at the rehearsal, we were working with all of the dances were put together by Toon, together with Tommy Walsh and Priscilla Lopez. And they would work things out and then ultimately teach it to the rest of the crew. And we walked in, and Michael Stewart came in, and he put a little box in the middle of the stage where we were working, and he said, open the box. And it was very tiny, very small box. And I picked up the lid, and there was looked like a feather, and I picked up the feather, and I pulled out a 30 feet a feather boa from this little box. And he said she could wrap herself in that, and it'll look fabulous. And so actually what happened was, it happened this fast. I mean, Tommy Walsh was standing on one side of the stage holding the boa as Priscilla, imagining herself to be Liliane, pulled the rest of it, and so we now had 30 feet of boa across the stage. And I thought, well, why don't I just make this a waltz? As I played this little waltz, which was based on Folie Bergère, Priscilla began to turn around and walk towards Walsh, keeping the boa taut. And by the end of it, she was wrapped in this gorgeous boa. And it was a stage event. It's all done with smoke and mirrors. And there it was. And then we could have this fabulous ending. you know, we gave it to Montevecchi, and she wrapped herself around it. At the end of the wall, she said, I love it. And so we kept that in, I love it. And then that was, you know. But that wasn't the end of it, because you see, we hadn't solved the problem of how do we get the boa to her? How do we get her the boa? Well, that was another day of thinking, and then finally somebody said, well, it makes no sense at all. It's completely surreal, so the kid can give her the boa. Guido's earlier self, the child, can give it to her as a present. And so we interrupted the note, the number, right in the middle of the number. And Liliane began to talk to the audience, because she was explaining, hello, this is Folies Bergère. I am a vedette, you know what this means, an actress at the Folies Bergère, and I am a star. And suddenly we brought the little boy on stage with a little box, and she said, who are you? And everything that she said we wrote down, and that became the text. And are you French? No, nobody's perfect. And ultimately, is that a present for me? And he gives her the present. And so from a non-singing role, which was supposed to be a couple of notes, this became a tiny reminiscence of the Folies Bergère, which became the action begins in the graveyard, followed by Folies Bergère, followed by the critics obbligato, followed by 3 minutes of talking to the audience. Hello, darling, there were a few flowers in my dressing room. Did you send them to me? Was it you? Was it you? Etc. Then the boy comes in, interrupts, gives her the present, puts down the present. The boy leaves. She takes out the boa. We do the waltz. She wraps herself in the waltz. She says, I love it. We have a rousing ending with Showgirls. It's a huge number that nobody thought could conceivably have existed. And Liliane Montevecchi wins the Tony Award for Best Featured Actress in a Musical. And that is how musical theater works.